Hello everyone, in today's video, this will be an hour's worth of old stories I have previously narrated on my channel, so this will be a compilation. But without further ado, let's get straight into these stories. Here is a little bit of background. I was 20 at the time. I moved in with my uncle in San Antonio, Texas, with the agreement that I didn't have to pay rent as long as I helped him out with chores and my cousins. I got a job at a super known coffee chain downtown close to the touristy part of the area. We had a lot of regulars and a lot of homeless coming in and out. I felt relatively safe though because I got to know the people there and it was almost always a lot of foot traffic. I used to even take walks after work in the area, especially since I was super close to the Riverwalk. Skipped to a couple of months into the job and I was friends with everyone I worked with. We were all super close. On this particular day, it was one of my coworkers' last day. There was about three guys who had been in there almost all morning. They hadn't bought anything and were just hanging out, which was not unusual for my location. On my break, I decided to walk down to a nearby drugstore so I can get a farewells card and maybe a small gift for said coworker. I walked out and put my earphones in, and before I could press play, I hear the door open behind me and footsteps following behind. Whoever it was caught up to me and started walking beside me, matching my pace exactly. I turned to look and it was one of the guys that had been there all morning. He was a bit taller than me. He tried to ask for my number and I kindly told him no. He persisted and I, with a short temper, told him to screw off. He stopped and stared at me in surprise. He stood there as I walked away and by the time I went back, they were gone. I proceeded to tell my coworkers about the encounter and we laughed it off. I thought that would be the end of it. I was wrong. Every shift after that, he would already be there just hanging out or would walk in mid-shift. Sometimes with somebody else and sometimes by himself. I assumed he was just another homeless person because how else was he always able to be around? My shifts were sporadic. Some days I opened, some days I closed, some days I worked mid, but it didn't matter, he was always there. At that point I started feeling paranoid. I would always catch him staring in my direction. He never ordered anything, never talked to me, and luckily wouldn't follow me. He would just sit there, watching me. I started mentioning it to my coworkers and they started noticing it too. One of my team leaders would help me out by sending me to wash dishes in the back or organize the cooler. My coworkers would also try and place themselves to try and block me from his view. I started feeling uncomfortable at work. Sometimes when I closed, a coworker would walk me to my car before heading home themselves. Or if I didn't close, they would walk me to my car and turn around and head back to work. Then one day of him just staring, I was working the register that day. He walked up and ordered a water. I asked for his name for his order. I now had his first name just in case. He took his water and sat down. I had mentioned him before to my manager, but because he hadn't really done anything, we couldn't do anything besides note it in the manager book. The next day I worked with my manager. It was him, two other co-workers, and me. I told him I had to go to the bathroom real quick. There were two bathrooms right next to each other, but sort of hidden from the coffee bar and register, and they weren't gender specific. I walked around the bar to the lobby area. I had to pass his table and walk down the lobby to get to the bathrooms. I noticed him get up before going inside the bathroom. I sat down to do my business when someone rattled the knob. I shouted out that it was occupied, but whoever it was kept rattling the door until I finished. When I opened the door, no one was there, and walking back I noticed him adjusting back into his chair. I was super freaked out and told my boss. He couldn't tell him anything because we had no proof that it was him. Later that shift he got up and picked up a coffee from the pickup area. My boss assumed that he had ordered it and let him take it. I told him it wasn't and that it wasn't even his name. My boss used this as an opportunity to tell him if he does something like that, he can't come back. The man apologized and actually stuck to the rules every day after that. He went back to just watching me. Cut to Valentine's Day. One of my team leaders and I would be scheduled to work certain Thursdays after close to deep clean the store. We would stay until 1 a.m. This was one of those Thursdays. We were almost done and I had to clean the bathrooms as one of the last chores. I finished and as I walk out the bathroom, I see him peeking in with both his hands, pressed to the window, eyes wide, just staring at me with this super intense look. I froze for a second, just staring back. I notice on one of his palms, that is pressed to the window, a purple foam heart. He doesn't move at all. I freak out and run back into the bathroom. I shout, "Hannah, Hannah, he's here, he's back." She barely hears me through the music we were blasting. Hannah was the team lead who would help me hide me from him, so she knew the huge fear I had towards him. She walks towards the bathroom shouting back, "What are you saying? What's going on?" As soon as she gets close, she sees him. I told her again, "He's here. He's watching me." She started shouting through the window, "You need to leave. If you don't leave, we're calling the police." I step out a little to see if he'll leave and he's ignoring her and his eyes were fixated in my direction. I step back into the bathroom and my lead continues to shout at him to leave and threatens him with the police. About 5 minutes pass and he realizes that I'm not stepping out until he leaves, so he does. The next day, my lead and I told my manager I want to file a police report, and he tells me to wait until he talks to his boss. He shows up again that day, and I was only there to talk to my manager and leave right after. When I got home, a friend convinced me to call the cops. So I text my boss that I don't care what he or his boss says, I'm scared, and I'm gonna file that report. I dial 911 and tell them a summarized version. They tell me they're going to send someone to where I live to take the official report. The two officers were nice and supportive. I told them my whole story and how my boss didn't feel the need to get cops involved since I wasn't harmed. The officers told me that I should have called right away and defend me, saying they could get him for harassment. I thank them and they tell me that if he shows up to dial 911 so they can take him in for trespassing and harassing. I think that day my manager banned him and warned him because he never showed up to the coffee shop again. A few months later, when I was comfortable again with downtown, I went out with some friends to walk around. We were close to where I worked at, and as we round a corner, I see him, and so I ducked into a little corner store and my friends follow. I told them I saw him and they kept an eye out. Once he was out of view, we left the store and that was the last time I saw him. I just hope that he never comes back. I'm in a school still and work for my family member on certain weekends at a local college selling concessions at the stadium. It's about once, twice a month, and the stadium is off towards the edge of town. It's Friday night, and I'd just gotten out of school, and I had to go straight to work. I get to work, work for 4 hours, half shift tonight, and my boss, my aunt, tells me we need more spoons for tomorrow's event. We sell ice cream, and these events have like 5,000 plus people at them. I say okay, and I'll go grab them on my way home. The only store open with heavy-duty spoons is all the way on the other side of town, and I still wanted to go meet up with some of my friends and mess around. I decide to take the faster but more sketchy way around the outskirts of town. I live in a weather bipolar state. It snowed last night, but I figured the roads would be fine enough even if they weren't plowed. I take off to the store and the first 5 minutes go by and nothing's wrong. I haven't seen a single car or any buildings the entire time, but keep in mind it's approaching 9 p.m. and I'm on the outskirts of town, and no one really takes this way in case they really have to. All of a sudden I see something in the corner of my eye, and it looks like a man, roughly 5'8" I'd say, wearing shorts, t-shirt, and a backwards hat. He's in the ditch, walking in snow when it's 10 degrees out. My first thought is to pull over, but I'm on the phone with my mom at the time and she warns me not to, as some things have happened before in this town. I consider stopping, but for some reason I tell myself not to. I wasn't really worried about anything. I pass the man, going about 40 miles per hour. Like I said, roads aren't the best. I drive not even 500 feet past him, and immediately, a car that I did not see at all before turns on and pulls out of a field entrance off the road and starts to follow me. At first I thought I just was focused on the man in the ditch and didn't see a road and that's where they come from, but I later found out there was not a road there. I start to approach the town again and have to take some turns to get to where I'm going. I turn left, the car turns left. I turn right, the car turns right. I go around a roundabout and skip my turn and go twice as no one else was there, car follows. At this point I start to worry a little, but maybe they just need to go to the store also. I then pull up to a stop sign and I turn without my turn signal, the car follows. Now at this point I should have went straight to the police station, but I still didn't think much of it. I'm 2 miles from the store, where plenty of people will be. I take a few more turns and the car continues to follow me. I completely blew a stop sign at a non-busy intersection and the car does a quick stop and go and catches up. At this point, I have 2 turns till the store, so I'm still not worried. I turn into the store and the car turns also. The store also has a gas station, so I pull there first to act like I was getting gas. The car sets off to the side of the road, in between gas station and store, and just sits there. I wait about 10 minutes and the car doesn't move. At this point, I start to get worried. I call my friends I'm supposed to meet up with later on and give them the license plate for worst case scenario, then take off to the store. I cross the street and the car comes straight behind me. I'm freaking out on the phone, not knowing if I should call the cops or not. I go and park as close as possible to the store, and the car parks 3 rows behind me and a couple down. It's getting late at this point and the store's closing soon, there's only a couple others in the lot. I turn my truck back on and go park on the complete opposite side of the lot, get out, and I completely bolt inside the store. I get spoons and take my time in the store. I go to call my friends to walk back outside, and my phone is dead. I look out the sliding doors and suddenly there's a white van next to my driver's side. Looks like no one's in it, but the back windows are covered and it's running. I run to customer service and explain everything, but they think I'm some young kid messing around. At that time, I didn't see the original follow car, but no way I'm going outside with that van next to my truck. After waiting for about 30 minutes, the van pulls forward, and the original car appears from the side of the building. I wait another 10 minutes and dash outside. I speed to my friend's house, and when I get there, I park at his garage. My one buddy asked why there's a big orange mark on my tire, and my heart sinks. When I was inside, the fellow car must have marked my tire. After inspecting the rest of my truck, we find a small pipe dropped in the bed of my truck surrounded by snow. It was wrapped in duct tape. It was not mine. I was alone, no phone, scared, in a part of town I'm not familiar with. I can't help but think what would have happened if I walked outside. Last December, I was visiting my family down in Florida and we spent some time in Treasure Island. My brother and I took my dog down to the beach at about 2 a.m. to play some fetch and drink and have a good time. If you walk along the water, you can reach a few restaurants and bars and hotels that line the beach. Out of nowhere, we see someone walking pretty quickly in our direction from over there, and a few minutes later, we can make out that they're being followed. My dog is arguably pretty well trained. We work search and rescue, and I've never once had her run off without permission, and never once has she not instantly returned when called, but that changed that night. She was about 5 feet from me and I saw her hackles shoot up and I went to grab her collar, but she took off in a full sprint, making some truly terrifying barking and growling sounds. We obviously took off after her and she reached the first person and stopped between them and the people behind them. She was barking and growling and lunging and I finally caught up and put her on a leash. She's never reacted in that manner, so it was scary. The group following her ended up being 3 men that were probably in their early 30s. They started booking it in the other direction. I turned around and the person being followed was a young woman around my age. We asked if she was okay and she just broke down in tears and collapsed into my brother. So she got into her phone and rang her friend's number to have us talk to her. We were able to figure out where she was staying and walk her back to her hotel where we met up with her friends and we all exchanged numbers to talk a later time. The next day we all got together where we learned she had gone out for a walk on the beach, stopped for a drink at the bar, drank a bit, and then just wasn't feeling right. So she left the bar and soon noticed 3 men left after her. She had been walking for about a mile at that point, terrified and slowly getting more and more screwed up. She doesn't remember much about that night and we knew she was probably on something, but we had no clue she'd been drugged. We're still friends now and we're all gonna meet up for spring break when we're all back in Florida. I've never been more proud of my dog and more grateful that we were in the right place at the right time. I hate thinking about what could have happened. I'm an extremely outdoorsy female and love to spend a lot of time in nature. I spent the better part of my early 20s living in remote northern locations and exploring a lot of Alaska, Yukon, and British Columbia. I have many odd, frightening, and bizarre stories that came up from my time in the north, and this is one of them. In the summer of 2012 when I was 22, I'm 26 now, I was living and working in a pretty remote town in northern British Columbia from May to September. The place I worked at was a campground in the provincial part of the Alaskan Highway, 4 hours north of Fort Nelson and 2 hours south of the Yukon-British Columbia border. The best part about this park was the fact that it had beautiful natural hot springs, which attracts tourists from all over North America every summer. I lived in an old trailer on a separate part of the campground where the rest of the staff lived. I quickly got used to living in a place where I had no running water, no electricity, no cell phone service, and no internet, and driving 4 hours to Fort Nelson every 2 weeks to get groceries and do my laundry. Life was pretty sweet. I got to hike, go for late night dips in the springs, make some traveling friends, and spend quality time in nature getting to know the flora and fauna of the landscape. My job at the campground was being a park facility operator, gatehouse attendant, wildlife interpreter, and sometimes had a few security shifts here and there. The feeling of living in the woods was much different than the feeling of living in a city, as far as safety goes. In the city I'm from, there are people around. You're aware of the fact that your house or apartment could get broken into, but emergency services are quick to respond and neighbors are also a plus. However, in the woods, I felt more vulnerable. The closest police were 4 hours away, and I lived in a trailer that was run down enough that it could easily get broken into. Plus, it was pretty dark and anyone could sneak around easily at night. One night, at probably around 2 in the morning, I'm asleep inside my trailer and I'm awoken up to a very loud banging on my trailer door. Reasonably shaken, I look outside the window next to my bed and see a car with its lights on, and 2 men standing at my door. I can feel the blood drain from my face. Through the door I say, "How can I help you?" and one of the guys, clearly hammered out of his mind, starts rambling on about something. No matter how hard I try, I cannot understand what he is saying. I say, "Sorry, I don't understand what you're trying to tell me," and the other guy starts frantically trying to explain something in the same drunken state as the first guy. I decide at this point that they don't mean any harm and I open the door to talk to them. They look visibly shaken and I can tell they are desperate for my help but don't have the mental capacity of a person sober enough to coherently tell me what's wrong. One of the dudes starts telling me a very long story that I managed to piece together through all of his slurring and hiccuping. Basically, he says that him and his friend are on vacation, came up from Fort Nelson to party, they had a really long drive, were at the hot springs, they were having beers, and they were sorry about having beers. And then he drops the bomb that somebody's running around the campground, stabbing people. I look at the guy telling me the story and notice he has blood all over his clothing. I say, "Someone is going around stabbing people?" And he replies, "Yes, someone's running around stabbing everybody." Then the other guy yells, "Come on, let's go," and they hop into the aforementioned car and speed off before I can question them any further. Now I'm standing at my trailer door, in the darkness, alone, thinking there's a maniac running around wielding a knife. I have no phone, and I know that the only person who has a phone is the ranger, and his cabin is about a 5-minute walk away from my trailer. I remember that I have a radio, so I run inside my trailer, lock the door, and try to get the ranger on the radio. His radio is off, of course. The only thing I can do at this point is go to the ranger's cabin and notify him of the situation. I get to the ranger's cabin and pound on his door. He answers within a few minutes, visibly sleep-deprived. And I tell him the whole story. While I'm there, he calls the police and they tell him that they are on the way and they will be there in 4 hours. The ranger grabs my gun, walks me back to my trailer, and says, "Don't let anybody in." I stay up the rest of the night, listening for any sort of disturbance around me, the intense kind of listening where you're concentrating so hard on any external sounds that might be made that you almost feel deaf from the silence. After about 2 hours of doing this, my trailer starts rocking back and forth. I freeze. My heart drops. I can hear the sound of someone breathing extremely heavily, and I'm thinking, this is it. I'm just sitting there on my bed in my trailer as it's rocking, waiting for the maniac to stop tormenting me and just break the window and stab me. I'm still listening intently to the heavy breathing, and that's when I hear a grunt, a very non-human sounding grunt. I get a feeling that it's not what I think it is, and I peer out the window of my trailer and a bison is scratching its back on the side of my trailer, causing it to rock back and forth. The RCPM get there at around 6:30 a.m. and proceed with their investigation for 10 hours. They close off the springs in the entire campground. We don't hear anything about what took place during the night until the investigation is over. Apparently there was a guy at the springs who made a lewd comment about one of the females in another group, which resulted in an argument. The guy disappeared and returned an hour later with a knife, stabbed two of the guys in the group, and booked it back to Fort Nelson, not before stopping at my trailer with his buddy to tell me about the incident, of course. Yeah, one of the guys at my trailer, he was the dude stabbing people. My guess is that him and his friend stopped by my trailer to try to make it seem like they were innocent. Drunken logic. The two guys that were stabbed survived, which is good. I just hope that I never have to wake up to someone like that at my door again. A couple of years ago, I was still adjusting to the adult dating scene. I was using Tinder, and though I had been on a few dates and had a few hookups, it was mostly just situations where I either wasn't that interested in the guys, or it was strictly a one-night stand. It was a college town, not where I went to school, about 45 minutes from my parents' house, and I went on a few dates there. It's a cool city to hang out in, so it was always worth the journey, even if a date didn't work out. I started chatting with this guy who I matched with on Tinder. He wasn't exactly my usual type, but he was charming enough. He was a little bit of the stoner slash alternative type. He was funny and confident over the phone as well. I usually made it a rule for myself to chat on the phone at least once or twice before meeting up with guys. Even just to gauge if we would be able to carry a conversation. It's not the same when you're only texting. We hit it off over the phone well enough to the point where I felt we should give hanging out a shot. We talked about how I went to karaoke night often at a local bar close to where I attended school. He said he and his friends liked going to karaoke too. Great. He lived in the previously mentioned college town, and I agreed to attending karaoke night with him and his friends. He said they were hanging out at a local coffee shop near where he and his roommate lived, and I could meet them there. A girl he knew worked there as well, and he said she'd give me a coffee on the house. Before leaving, I texted one of my friends where I was going, just to be safe. When I arrived, I could clearly see into the coffee shop. I could see a group of four scraggly looking dudes, and one girl behind the counter. As soon as I pulled up, I got a nagging bad feeling in my stomach. As soon as I got out of the car, the guy I'd been chatting with left his group and came out. He said they were leaving right now so we should just go. Not that I really cared about the coffee, but what happened to the coffee I was promised? I asked exactly what the plan was, and he said they were going to head back to his place before heading to karaoke. He didn't ask if I wanted anything from the shop, and didn't even ask if I wanted to come in. By this point, his friends came out and they all got close to my car. I was getting pretty bad vibes at this point. He isn't acting charming or funny like before on the phone. Everything felt forced. There was an air from the group that they were only pretending to be friendly. Nobody introduced themselves, but they just kept saying how awesome karaoke at the bar was. The girl inside at the counter had gone in the back of the shop, and because she was friends with him, I didn't know if I could trust her. Thinking quickly, I said the plan sounded great, and I could drive and meet them there, that I didn't want to leave my car there. This apparently was a problem. The one car in the parking lot, which I assumed was one of theirs, was the girl's. They said they walked there, but it would be a lot better and faster if I just drove them back to the house. At this point, I'm freaking out a bit. Everyone's close to my car and me. I tell them a stupid lie and say that I have a bunch of stuff from school in my car, and it's pretty messy on top of that. So not everyone will be able to fit in. Mind you, they are right by my car, standing in front of it. They can see through my windshield into it. It's got like a backpack in it, and that's just it. I just lie and say I'm kind of embarrassed because the floor's messy. I'm saying anything I can get out of this. I tell them I'm really sorry, but if they order an Uber, I could just meet them at their place. I'm not budging on not letting them get in my car. The guy I'm supposed to be on a date with tells the other guys to head back inside the coffee shop, and now I'm alone with him. He asks why I can't just drive everyone. He tells me it's not a big deal, and that it's just easier if I just drive everyone there. I stand firm that there's not room and my car's messy. I tell him I promise to meet him at his place if they order an Uber or walk, just text me his address. He says that it'll take too long to get back to his place, so I should just meet them at the bar instead. He won't give me his address. He texts me the address to the bar, and I apologize about the car thing. I tell him I'm so excited for karaoke and I'll meet him there. I smile and act as naturally as possible, and then I get in my car and try to drive normally while in view. As soon as I'm out of sight, I take off and just drive in different directions haphazardly before heading back home. I was constantly watching in my mirrors to see if anyone followed me, and thankfully nobody did. Not long after arriving home, I got multiple texts from him. He told me I was just another girl pretending to be nice and that I deserved to die. Clearly, I made the right call. I blocked his number and blocked him on Tinder. I never heard from him again, and I hope it stays that way. This happened to me when I was about 10 years old, but even now as an adult in my 30s, I remember it like it was yesterday. My parents had taken my sister and I out to a movie, and then to get ice cream in celebration of my older sister getting straight A's on her report card. I remember my dad had gotten off work later than usual, so by the time the movie was over and we had our ice cream, it was well past our bedtime. It didn't matter though, my parents were happy and proud of my sister. We had a great time, and we took up our time getting home. If it wasn't for what happened when we got there, I would have always looked back fondly on this night. We got home at around 10:30. Bedtime is usually 10, so I went straight to my room to put my pajamas on while my sister went to brush her teeth. I remember thinking that it seemed a little more chilly in the house that night, but that's the only thing out of the ordinary I can recall from when we first walked in. I barely had a chance to change when I heard my dad yell our names from what I thought was the kitchen. I didn't know what was wrong, but I knew it was bad because I heard fear in his voice for the first time ever. It scared me really bad. I bolted out the door and into the kitchen as fast as I could. My sister was already there, and her and my parents were standing very close. My mom looked like she was on the verge of panic, and she motioned for me to come close. She wrapped her arms around my sister and I, and my dad was already dialing on the house phone. Then I noticed some glass on the floor. I asked my mom what was wrong, but she didn't want to tell me. She said we needed to go outside right away. As we headed out the front door, I heard my dad talking to a 911 operator and telling them that when we got home, he found our back sliding glass door shattered and objects strewn about the kitchen. He went to the neighbor's house and waited for the police to come. After a few minutes, my dad joined us. He seemed to be well shaken up, which was a new sight to me. The police arrived and searched the house extensively. It was a big scene with all of our neighbors outside, and flashing lights illuminating our entire street for hours. They never found anybody in our house. Whoever had been there had come and gone. The thing that gets to me is that nothing was stolen. Whoever it was didn't want any of our possessions. What they did take was our canned food out the pantry and stacked them into a small pyramid on our kitchen counter. They also turned on the TV in the basement and moved a few random objects to different parts of the house. It was like someone had been in our home and did things for reasons that only made sense to them. As the police were finishing up and ready to leave, I heard one of them ask my mom a question. They talked quietly, and I'm sure they thought I didn't hear. I pretended not to be listening, but I heard everything. We kept magnetized letters on our fridge, and we used them to leave each other messages for fun sometimes. The cop was asking my mom if the message on there that night was done by any of us. It wasn't. I watched my mom turn pale when we told her what it said. It still makes my skin crawl to this very day. It said, "Always watching." The police didn't find any fingerprints. They said the intruder had to be wearing gloves. For the next few days, the entire family was extremely uneasy. Within a few months, we decided to move. It was all just too scary for us to stay in that area. We moved to a house several miles away. We were never bothered again, but I do still think about it. This happened many years ago, but the hairs on my neck still stand up sometimes to this day. I just wish that we never experienced something like that again. In April of last year, my boyfriend and I were walking home from our friend's house, and I had just finished my first year at college and we wanted to go out and celebrate and have some fun. We live in a rural town and our friend lived on the far side of it, so our walk was about a half an hour or so. I had a drink or two and smoked some of the joint they had rolled. Smoking makes me paranoid, and this night was no different. Anyway, we left at maybe 10 or 11 p.m. and everything was perfectly normal until we got to the end of the long street that would eventually lead to my house. This street always feels so long to walk on, like hours can pass and you can barely make a dent in the amount of steps made. The street we turned onto this road was maybe 10 blocks from my house. A few minutes after we turned onto this road, I felt like something was off, but my boyfriend said that I was stoned and reassured me that it was just that. This white pickup truck that was parked in front of some house turns on and begins to drive slowly away and would then park. I watched it to see if it was just me being paranoid or not, but it proceeded to stop a couple houses down and sat there with the car still on. As soon as we get close, it would drive away, parking a little further away. This continued on until we got to the end of my street. At this point, I kept telling my boyfriend that I'm not paranoid and that this truck was screaming with us and he had gone quiet. A couple houses down from mine, this truck drives to the end of the street, my house on the corner. There's a dead end by my house because we live near a river. It stops for a moment at the dead end and proceeds to turn on their high beams and begin to slowly drive towards us. My boyfriend sticks his arm out in front of me, stopping me from walking any further as this truck continues to approach. My house is so close, yet so far. This truck slowly drives by us. The windows are tinted, but we can see two silhouettes. And because they had blinded us, we didn't think to look at the license plates or even the model of the truck. My boyfriend, being pretty quick on his feet, waited until the truck disappeared from sight and took my hand before racing to my house and locking the door. He had thought about turning down one of the other streets so we could try to lose them, but he figured he'd wait until they were out of sight to book it to my house so they wouldn't see which house we went in. We looked out one of the front windows very carefully and saw this truck come back into view and began to drive around the block, I'm assuming looking for us. This went on for about 10 minutes. I called the police to inform them that we had been followed, but without the license plates or model, they could only keep their eyes open for suspicious white trucks. I was adamant that these people had to know one of us, if not me, because they drove until they were beside my house. Whether they actually knew it was my house or not, I don't know. My boyfriend tries to insist that it was probably a bunch of kids trying to mess with us, but I don't believe that. A few days later, we heard that someone was picked up and was last seen in a white truck. Since this night, there have been stories in the paper and online that people have been grabbing people and these people were trafficked in the area. I'm still seeing reports even today. So when I was about 15 or so, I would always go grocery shopping with my mom. This time she didn't just need groceries, but some other things that weren't close by. We lived out in the country and the closest town didn't have what she needed, so we went to the bigger town / city about an hour away. Our last stop was the grocery store, as my mom didn't want to leave a bunch of groceries in the car on a hot summer day while she got whatever else she needed. While we were there, I noticed an older man, tall, skinny, semi-ill looking, that was paying a lot of attention to us. I also caught him talking to himself a lot. I almost ran into him when we were switching aisles and I said sorry, and since then I had seen him like 5 times and every time I felt a shudder and I looked around and he would be somewhere staring at me. I told my mom and she said we were almost done. A few minutes later, we got distracted talking about ice cream. I was telling her about this ice cream brand that my brother, who's a health nut, told me about, and that it was supposed to be a lot better for you than well-known name brands. We started searching for it. I was on one end of the aisle, and she was on the other. I ended up finding it, and reached into the freezer to grab it. When I turned around, the old man was right behind me, like way too close. He said something like, "You're too pretty to be eating that. It'll rot your teeth." And I freaked out. I pushed past him and ran back to my mom and said, "Found it, let's go." And she saw the look on my face and looked past me and saw the man. We headed quickly for the registers, and unfortunately we had a lot of groceries and the old man got in the line next to us and only had a few things. He kept talking to himself. I was keeping a very close eye on him and was relieved when he exited the store. But unfortunately, that wasn't the end of it. When we left the store, I noticed him sitting in his car outside the doors. He sat there and watched us put the groceries in the car and got behind us as we went to go leave the parking lot. I was freaking out. My mom told me it would be okay and that she was right there with me. We ended up taking some back roads home. My mom thought maybe he would get lost. As I said, we were about an hour away from home, and the back roads made it even longer. We were about 5 to 10 minutes away from home and he was still following us. When I asked my mom if I should call the cops, she said, "No, call your dad and tell him what's going on. Tell him to be waiting outside with the shotgun." So I called my dad and told him what was happening, and he had an idea. Since we lived way out in the country, my parents' neighbor was about half a mile down the road from us. They had a long driveway that you can't see their house from the road. He told me to have my mom go there instead so that the guy wouldn't know where we lived. My dad got there first, told the neighbor what was going on, and they both grabbed their shotguns and waited outside for us to pull up. The guy followed us down the long dirt driveway, and as soon as he got to the clearing with the house and saw my dad and our neighbor with their guns out, he threw his car into reverse and hightailed it out of there. So far since that incident, my family nor I have seen that man again, and I hope it stays that way. This happened a few years ago, in my old one-person flat. I had a strange feeling that something wasn't right for a few days. Like I was sure that food in the fridge was less than I put back the last time. I found pills for my couch on the floor, stuff like that. I lived alone back then, so there wasn't anyone else with access to my flat, or so I thought. Well, one night I woke up around 1 in the morning sweating from a nightmare. Since I was drenched in sweat, I decided to take a shower. So I put my phone up in the bathroom for music, turned on the water, and enjoyed my shower. A few minutes in, I heard the door move. I never close it, but it still never moves. I took a look at the shower curtain and saw a shadow against it, and a look at my phone confirmed someone was there, since I could clearly see a reflection on my screen that showed someone was standing next to the shower curtain. It took me a lot not to scream and to keep acting like I didn't notice anything, while silently taking the shower head off the holding and turning the water all the way to hot. Our water got really hot when you cranked it all the way to hot, and a few seconds later steam was raising and the water hurt my feet flowing to the drain. I turned around, ripped the shower curtain open, and held the shower head right at the person behind. It was a woman and she screamed in pain. I whacked her in the face with the shower head and jumped out the shower and ran to the door, taking the key out of the lock and locking it closed behind me. A little later she started to bang on the door, but the door didn't give. I called the cops and went to the kitchen to get my big kitchen knife, just for safety. I felt like my throat was closing up when I saw it missing and realized there was only one place where it could possibly be right now. The police came and arrested the woman, who turned out to have been the former person living in the flat and was evicted after not paying rent. Seems she made a copy of the key and came into the flat when I was at work and sometimes at night. I just hope that I never have to experience that again. This happened 5 years ago. I was 25 and used to live alone in a small flat in England, about an hour south of London. It was a medium-sized town well known for being a good place to live, with excellent schools, low crime rates, and minimal unemployment. The kind of place where people didn't panic if they left their front door unlocked when they left for work. My flat was on the first floor above pavement level, midway down a hill. There was nobody underneath me. My flat was a kind of bridge with a footpath below it, and my kitchen window was directly over a pavement on a fairly busy road. The flat had a small galley kitchen, a living room, and an upstairs bedroom. There was nobody beneath or above my flat, and because of the hill, my kitchen window was literally face-on with the pavement and where people walked. There was a printing company opposite that went out of business, and then just grass. I always used to close the blinds once the sun had gone down, but liked having the kitchen window open during the afternoons. It had a safety latch so it didn't open far enough for anybody to reach in, and I was not on the ground floor, so I didn't worry too much. One day, I got home from work early, about 5:30, and as it was summer, I had the kitchen window open and the blinds open. I'm chopping garlic for my dinner, glance up, and see an older man literally stood on the pavement watching me, only a few feet away. I glare back as if to say, go away, and decide to walk out the kitchen into the living room as if I'm talking to someone. I walk back into the kitchen, glance at the window, and the man is still there, watching me with a small smile on his face. At this point, I am slightly panicked. I am alone, nobody's around, as I have no direct neighbors. I go into the living room and sit against the wall, clutching my phone. I didn't want him to be able to see me at all. A lot of front doors in England have a kind of two-door system. Directly on the street, you have a glass door, normally with decorations on them so you can't see everything in and out, just blurred images, and a proper wooden door inside. I had been out for a smoke, so the glass door was shut and locked, but the wooden door was wide open. From where I'm sitting, I can see the glass door, and I see a figure walking towards it. Sure enough, as it gets closer, I can see that it's the man from the pavement, standing at my front door and trying to look in. He tries opening the door, but luckily, I locked the outside door after my smoke, and it was a strong door. He drops a cigarette, says, screw it, and after about 15 to 20 seconds, he turns around and walks away. I run to shut and lock the wooden door and go to the kitchen window as he walks away and down the road. Just before he turns the corner, turns around and smiles at me, making eye contact. A few days later, it was on the local news that a man matching his description chased down a group of young women in my neighborhood. This happened almost 2 years ago. I had decided to go hiking with my son, who was 8 months old at the time, and with my dog named Henry, who is an Irish Wolfhound and Rottweiler mix. My husband was going fishing with a mutual friend at a state park nearby. I decided to go hike one of the more remote trails in a different part of the park and then meet them later. I drove to a wooded trail about 10 minutes from where my husband was fishing. It was an early spring day, still chilly but tolerable with the sun shining. I parked the car and got my son ready. He was smiling and laughing. I would wear him in a forward-facing hiking sling in the front of me at the time. Henry was excited. We started off on the hike and it was a really beautiful, peaceful trail. Towering trees mixed with pine. A crystal clear creek wove its way through the trail at points. We would periodically stop and all three of us would play. About an hour and a half into the hike, we had gone about 3 miles and rounded a narrow bend in the trail when we nearly collided with a gentleman in his late 40s or early 50s. Henry was snarling and lunging for the man. Before I even completely registered what was going on, I quickly backed up and pulled Henry back the best I could. My bumps were goosed at this point. Henry would not calm down. This is very unusual behavior for him, but not if he was trying to protect us. Trying to talk over Henry, I loudly said, "I'm sorry, Henry is just very protective of my son. If you move off to the side, we can pass you." My son was very quiet during this entire exchange, which I found a bit odd. The guy was staring very intently at my son. He then laughed slightly and said, "Oh, he should be. It's a good thing he's with you." Then he motioned to something around his neck and said, "I'm just out here taking pictures. It's a hobby of mine." Except he wasn't wearing any kind of camera around his neck or anywhere that I could see. He had a canteen around his neck. I politely asked him again to step aside so that we could pass. At this point, Henry was sitting down but growling still. Henry would not take his eyes off this guy. I have no doubt that Henry would have eviscerated this man if he had tried anything. I am positive this guy felt that. The guy looked at Henry for a few seconds, then at my son again. He took a few steps off trail so there was room to get by and so that Henry couldn't reach him when we went by. As I warily walked by him, he was like 10 feet to my left. He muttered something about how he used to be able to see his kids. I kept looking back as we walked away to make sure he wasn't turning around to walk our way. He did continue to stare after us for several minutes though until I could no longer see him. We kept hiking and eventually came to an opening point where cars would park. There was no one there and luckily I still had cell phone reception. I called my husband. He and his friend came to pick us up right away and they took us back to my car. There was no sign of the guy we encountered. We went home after that. Henry has since passed away and I am sad that my son doesn't get to grow up with him. He was really the best dog ever. So, thanks Henry for being gentle yet fierce. I hope I never have to see that photographer ever again. This story happened about 2 years ago when I was 19 and my foster sister, Kira, was 16. It was the summer before I was going to college, and I mostly lived with my mom and Kira except for every other weekend, where I'd stay with my dad. Now, summers where I am can get really hot and humid, so we had a habit of waiting to walk the dogs until 6 or 7 p.m, because that's when it'd be cooler but still light outside. On this particular evening, mom wasn't going to be home until late, so it was up to me and Kira to walk the dogs by ourselves, unless we wanted our younger dog, Samson, to throw tantrums due to pent-up energy. Even though we lived in the countryside and could have walked them down our street, Kira and I decided to drive out 20 minutes to a park instead. At around 7:30 p.m, Kira and I harnessed our two dogs, packed them up in the car, and drove them to the park. Let me quickly explain the layout of the park so that's easier to understand why we get nervous halfway through our walk. This park isn't very big, but it's popular because of its loop. The entire park is surrounded by a mile-long looping road with its attractions, like playgrounds, ponds, and a small country hall, spaced about in the inner side of the loop. The outer side is just grass, trees, and one playground at its end. Thus, it's common and expected to pass people walking the loop at least 2 times if you're walking in opposite directions, but not if you're walking in the same direction. Any cars on this road can only drive in one direction because it's a one-way road. At first, everything about this walk was normal. I parked the car, we clipped our dogs to leashes, and we started on the loop. Every so often, we'd stop so I could take pictures of our good boys, particularly of Kira trying to wrangle Samson, who pulls like his life depends on it and weaves around because he wants to smell everything. It was while I was taking one of these pictures that the first encounter happened. A man, who looked to be in his 40s, walked past us, walking the same direction we were, up towards the playground on the outer side of the loop. He smiled at Kira, nodded, and said, "Hello, you have cute dogs," and kept walking. I honestly didn't think anything of it. We're at a park at a time of day where it's common to walk around due to the cooler temperature and people where I'm at are generally friendly. We smiled back and said, "Hi, and thanks," and that was that, or so we thought. This man passed us again only 10 minutes later, directly across from where we'd seen him previously. Just like he did before, he smiled and said, "Hi." This time, Kira and I looked at each other once he was ahead of us and shared the, well, that was weird, expression. Just 10 minutes earlier, he had passed us walking up towards the playground and subsequently broke off from the loop, and he'd been walking in the same direction as us. This time though, he cut in front of us and he did it in a way where we had to stop to avoid running into him. He nearly touched Kira with how close he was walking. That was already weird in and of itself. The other weird part was him cutting past us in the opposite direction. It came off almost like he wanted to walk by us again, but, just like before, Kira and I brushed this weirdness off. The guy could have been enjoying a rambling stroll and doing his own thing for all we knew. Not even 5 minutes later, the same man passed us again, once again cutting so close past us that he nearly brushed shoulders with Kira. Again, this time he walked up behind us, then did this weird directionally slant walk to cross the street and go in the opposite direction, cutting us off again. I told Kira to hustle so we could get to our car and get out instead of doing a second loop. When we were almost to our car, we noticed a car creeping along behind us. We pulled to the side and stopped to let it pass, but for a second it stopped too. We figured whoever was in the car was getting ready to park, so we started walking again. The car started creeping along behind us soon after we did, so we stopped again, and the car stopped with us. This is when Kira got nervous. We hadn't seen the middle-aged guy since the third cutoff, so we figured I had overthought the whole thing, but here we were, with this tinted-windowed car acting weird. Was it the same guy, back with his car? A different guy? We couldn't tell. Before anything could happen though, another car idled up to the one next to us, and whoever it was sped up to the expected 5 miles per hour. We got to our car pretty fast after that and practically picked up the dogs to get them inside of it. We got in and got out of there. My mistake, however, was neglecting my rearview mirror and the well-advised rule not to drive straight home if you're worried a stranger's taking too much interest in you. We got home at around 8-something. The sun had finally disappeared behind the horizon. Mom wasn't home yet, so we got the dogs some water, locked the doors, ate a late dinner, chilled in the living room, and talked about things that didn't really matter. It was almost 9:30 when the scariest part of this whole ordeal happened. There Kira and I were, sitting on different couches, talking about something, when we noticed the ceiling briefly light up over where Kira was sitting. Due to our long, slightly curvy driveway, it's common to see headlights stream through the window, light up the ceiling, fade, then intensify. It means someone's just come home, so when the ceiling above Kira lit up, we thought nothing of it, assuming Mom was finally coming back from wherever she went that night. Mom has a habit of pulling in then checking her phone for whatever knows how long before coming inside. After a couple of minutes, I noticed the small, motion sensor light Mom set up on a table on the porch light up. Right after the light went off, we both heard the storm door open, but we didn't hear anyone pressing the code keys of our lock or jiggling the door handle, like Mom usually does right away. The moment the storm door creaked open, our two dogs jumped up and ran to the door, barking like mad. Our golden greyhound mix, Calvin, has a deep and scary bark. Samson, who is a big dog, jumps up on his hind legs and scrabbles to one of the small windows in a desperate attempt to see who's outside. Immediately, the storm door slammed shut, and we heard heavy footsteps on the cement of our porch. Calvin started going nuts and jumped up on Kira's couch, standing on its back instead of the cushions to look out the window. Samson ran out the room and went out the doggy door that leads to the back porch, which is a ramp going down into a fenced-off portion of our yard. I sat there, my mind steadily going blank as my heart sped up and my limbs refused to move. Kira gets up and spins around and looks out the window but can't see anything because, besides the motion light on the porch, it's too dark. So, naturally, she gets up, grabs a stray dog toy which just so happens to be a tug-of-war rope with a ball on one end, and opens the door. I tell her very calmly to shut the door and stay inside. She ignored me and stepped out onto the porch. She comes back inside after not seeing anything, but, to my utter disbelief, she disappears into the kitchen, comes back with a knife, and goes outside again. This time, she's gone for a handful of seconds before running back inside and slamming the door shut. Breathless, she tells me she ran out a bit into the yard and saw the outline of a man by the run-down dog kennel we don't use anymore. When she saw him and froze, he moved. This time, she listened to me when I told her to lock the door. I managed to call Mom and she convinced me to get up and make sure all the doors were locked, including the basement and making sure the dogs were inside. After Mom got home and looked around, finding nothing, we called the non-emergency number for the police, not wanting to bother them in case we were overreacting. Two cops came by and walked around our yard and found nothing. We got the sense they didn't believe us, but instead saw us as two overexcited girls with exaggerated imaginations. Still, they humored us and told us, after we told them about the park, that if we think anyone might be following us, or if someone's acting a little too creepy, not to drive straight home and to check if anyone's following us. Then, they left. But when we heard those footsteps and Kira went outside, she swears she saw someone. The dogs don't run up to the door like that and bark their heads off if no one's there. I don't know if whoever was at our house was the same guy that ran into us at the park. If it was, I don't know the reason why he cut in front of us multiple times. I don't know if he was in the car that inched behind us and stopped when we stopped. I don't know what would have happened if Calvin didn't have a scary and manic bark. I don't know much of anything, but what I do know is, if you're out and about, minding your own business, and a stranger is taking a lot of notice of you, following you, frequently running into you, or whatever, trust your gut. Don't drive or walk straight home, meander, get to a public space, or just take your time. Pay attention to your surroundings. You never know who is watching you. This happened a few years ago when I was an 18-year-old girl in high school. I worked at a store in the mall of my mid-sized Midwestern city, and that evening, I worked a closing shift. I was walking back to my car in the snowy darkness when a black SUV pulled up beside me. A woman opened the window and yelled, "Hey, excuse me, I need your help." She was a round-faced woman in her 30s or 40s, and spoke with a very heavy Spanish accent. She went into a story about how her sister got into a car accident and the woman needed to get gas in her car before she could help the sister. However, she could not find a gas station and had no money, and she even said she had driven around to several churches to ask for help, but no one would help her. She was difficult to understand and did not tell the story super clearly, but I understood that she needed to find a gas station and she needed me to pay for it. She told the story between sobs and she seemed so desperate that I was moved to help her. I told her that she could follow my car to a gas station that was just across the highway, and that I would buy her some gas. At the gas station, I parked in front of the store and was surprised when she did not pull up to a gas pump, as I had expected. I got out of my car and said, "Okay, don't you want me to buy and pump gas for you?" She then said something like I had misunderstood her first story. She didn't need gas. She needed money to give to her sister, and added a bunch of other facts I don't remember to continue the story. Her accent and changing story was difficult to understand. I said, "Well, I don't have cash on me, only my card. I mean, I suppose I could see if there's an ATM inside?" She immediately replied that she knew there was, which definitely is suspicious in hindsight, but I didn't pick up on it at the time. I agreed to go in and get her some money from the ATM, and as I turned to go inside, she said, "Wait, but if you give me money, I will have to repay you somehow." I said, "No, that's okay, you don't have to." She said, "No, give me your phone number so I can contact you to meet up later so I can repay you, or give me your address and I will send the money to you." I refused both, and she tried again several more times, begging me to meet up with her later to give me the money. This probably lasted 5 minutes or so. Finally, as I refused her last time, she said in a very chilling way, "Don't be so nice." Despite all of this, I for some reason was still convinced she needed my help, and I went into the gas station to use the ATM. However, in my teenage wisdom, I could not remember my PIN number, and was unable to withdraw money. I went back outside to tell the woman, and she rolled her eyes, huffed something under her breath, and very quickly got into her car and sped off. I never saw her again after that. As I drove home, I became suspicious about the scenario. I figured out after a while that the woman was definitely trying to scam me for my money, but it disturbed me more that she tried so hard to get me to meet up with her later and give her contact information. I just hope that I never have to meet someone like that in the future. When I was young, I used to live in rural Pennsylvania. Where I lived wasn't quite suburbs, but the houses were all within walking distance of each other, and we knew nearly all of our neighbors. My small neighborhood was blocked off from the ones on either side by decent-sized creeks, and to get to them, you needed to climb down a fairly steep slope. This is an important detail later. My friend Rachel was a bit younger than me, by 2 or 3 years. I was 11 at the time. We had decided to go on a bike ride and ended up dropping our bikes and helmets at the top of the hill leading down to one of the creeks, and we went exploring. We were making a racket, I'm sure, squealing as we jumped around trying not to get wet. We noticed bubbles in the water and became concerned for the swans that lived down at the other end of the creek in the pond. Out of nowhere, we heard a man chuckling and he was standing at the top of the hill above near where we were standing. I said nothing. He asked what we were doing and slowly started making his way down the rough terrain of the slope. He obviously didn't know where the path to come down was. Rachel answered him that we were trying to find out where the bubbles were coming from and that she was scared it would hurt the swans, as there had never been any bubbles before today. He told us he could take a water sample and test it if we could bring it up to him, then asked our names and how old we were, still making his way down to us the entire time. Rachel told him her name and had started to say mine when I stopped her by grabbing her shoulder. I had an extremely bad feeling about this man, and I was very uncomfortable with the situation. I perked my head up looking off to the side and asked her, "Did you hear that, Rachel? I think your mom is calling us." I turned and dragged her up the path across from where the man was climbing down at, and we jumped on our bikes. I noticed this man's car parked next to where we put our bikes. Our helmets were missing. We heard the man scrambling after us, screaming that he hadn't heard anything. We started pedaling back toward my house, as Rachel lived in a different neighborhood, and the man started following us in a car after he finally reached the top. The man was still trying to get us to talk to him, so I turned off into my uncle's yard where I saw my cousin out cutting the lawn and started yelling for him. He was a big dude, 16 or so at the time, and the man in the car burnt rubber speeding off when he saw we were no longer alone. We ended up calling the police and we were not the first girls that had the same issue with the man of that description and that car that day. So whatever that man's intentions were, I'm just glad that Rachel and I didn't have to experience them. Alright, so that's it. I hope you enjoyed this compilation. Let me know down in the comments below if you want to hear another one of these compilations every once in a while. But as always, have a nice day.